in the literature, what do you do to predict currency crisis? The most common approach is using regression setting. You use a one-step or k-step ahead probability of deviation in the context of multivariate probability or logistic model. This is what, usually what is done in the literature. So you use these regression models to find the probability of deviation which gives you if you have a currency crisis. So what is good with this actually this approach that you can summarize all the information about the likelihood of this crisis in a single number, which is the probability of deviation. Also, you're going to consider all the variables simultaneously and take into account the independence. Let's say if these variables are these indicators are independent from each other, this you can understand that. But what's not good with this approach is that there's no actually metric for ranking the indicators, and you have nonlinear nature of this model, very nonlinear models, so it's very hard to assess the marginal contribution of a specific indicator at a point in time to a probability of the crisis. So we can use actually very different approach. We're going to introduce a signal approach, much easier approach. We're going to monitor the behavior of the specific indicators and record the abnormal behavior as signal. That's what we call signal. If something bad happening to this indicator, if there's something wrong happening, this is going to be called a signal. We're going to interpret abnormal behavior as deviation from trend. So you look at, for instance, the currency crisis, you look at specific indicators, you look at the trend of these indicators, how do they behave over time. And if you see that there's something abnormal happening, very high values, very low values, of course we have to quantify that, but if you see something bad happening, it's going to be signals. So you define a good signal as a signal followed by a crisis within 20 more, 24 months, if we have monthly data, or 2 years if we have annual data. So this is actually what's called a signal approach. Very elementary approach, which works pretty well, actually. You're going to see that. So the methodology, still apply to currency crisis. We already know how to do crisis using the previous criteria that I said earlier. So we know in our data, we know when crisis happening, which country we already know that. So which indicator should we now use? The tons of economic indicators. So which one do we have to use? The choice are dictated by theoretical consideration and availability of information. A lot of theory work on that. I won't go over the details, but we know basically which one should have an impact on which kind of crisis. And then we have to look for this information about it. This is something which is not necessarily easy to find this information. For currency crisis, I won't go into the details, the theoretical details about that because it's pretty heavy. But what we're going to consider is just the real exchange rate, exports and imports, M2 money, survival reserves, interest rates, and next thing. So now still in our methodology, we're going to filter our data by 21 percentage change to make sure that all units are comparable across countries, and to remove all the seasonality trends. Then we're going to introduce this notion of noise to signal ratio, the ratio of false signals to good signals. As I said earlier, I remind you, there is this 24-month window. If you have a signal in this window, and if the crisis follows in the next 24 months, you have good signals. Otherwise, you have bad signals. So we introduce this notion of noise to signal ratio. And of course, if this ratio is above 1, it means you have much more noise than signal, and it's not interesting. Obtain country-specific threshold. Again, country-specific study, which are defined in relation to the percentile of distribution of observation of the indicator. So you look at the specific indicator for this country, you look how it works, how it behaves, and then you want to define threshold for this country, so you look at the distribution of all these values in indicators, and you take the percentile of the distribution. So it's a very empirical approach. And then you find the optimal threshold for each country by minimizing the noise-to-signal ratio. So let's do quick performance analysis. How can you actually say that our method is performant? The effectiveness of the signal approach is at the level of individual indicators. Let's say country-specific, but we start by individual indicators, one at a time. We can build this simple matrix, basically, where you have you record your data on that. If a signal is issued in the 24 months before the real crisis, you increase this by one. If a signal is issued and no crisis happens, by one. Same thing for the others. And as you can see, if V equals C or 0, then you have a perfect indicator. This is the case in the sense that you always have a signal issued in a crisis, and no signal was issued, and you have no crisis. It's really the perfect case. And this is actually the false signals, the good signals, and the other case, you have V equals C equals 0, which you never had, of course, but this is the ideal case. So then what you can do, very elementary report, very simple probabilities. First, how can you calculate, of course, ratio of the single to maximum, no adjacent non single ratio. And then what you can do with this very elementary approach, you can always still calculate the probability of given crashes happening, given that the signal from the you have a signal from this indicator. Very simple. And you can calculate this marginal, as I told you, of the probability regression. You don't have this marginal approach. Now you can calculate these marginal probabilities that the crisis happening within this very simple division. Now, one of the last questions that we asked is how do we rank the various indicators? So we can do the analysis before all our indicators, M2 reserve, maximum to X. We can run the whole thing, but then how do we rank them? How do we say which one is the best for this type of crisis? How do we do it? Well, there are three criteria that we need to look at. The very first, the most natural way of ranking the indicators, the ability of to predict crisis we are focusing for products. So use the probability, the previous conditional probability. You look at the probability that the crisis is happening given that you have a signal from this indicator, and you obviously you take the biggest probabilities are going to be the best indicator. But the thing is, the problem is that this first way of ranking the indicator is silent about the late time of the indicator, in the sense that when you have a crisis happening, you look at the 24 months before, and a good signal is a signal that happens for at least 1 month in the last 24 months before a crisis. But it doesn't tell you if this signal is going to continue over time. It is just going to stop for 1 month, and then the next 12 months you have no signal at all, and then you have a crisis. It doesn't tell you anything about the late time of the signal. So you look at then the average number of months in advance of the crisis when the first signal occurs. You look at the first signal occurs, and you look at actually how much months that continue with the same signal. And then you always look at the persistence of signals. These last two are related to the stability of the signal. If the signal is persistent over time, in this 24-month window, this happens a lot of time. And you look at that. And you use these three ways of ranking the indicators. So I won't give very numerical results from what we did, because I talked already told about it, but using our approach with the concurrency crisis, we found really top three economic indicators. The imports, which probably signal 99% of currency crises. So we look at the past 100 years, and we look at all the currency crises, and we look at the export economic indicator, and using our approach, we're able to detect 98% of the currency crisis. Using the exports also, which makes sense, 96% of the prices. Exchange rates, we're able to signal 86% of the currency prices. So this is actually a first step. We did that for banking prices, we did that for all the kinds of prices, and last time. So it's pretty elementary report, pretty good results. And it's really easy to interpret and to work on. Future directions, as I mentioned earlier, this is a 2-year project, in the sense that this project is going to continue for 1.5 years now. A lot of things that need to be done yet. As I just talked about country-specific indicators and individual indicators, now what we're doing actually right now is to find a way to aggregate these indicators. A lot of indicators at the same time to find really build a big indicator. So this is something that's currently being done. Other stuff, the work on domestic debt crisis, which is also being done right now in parallel. This is something very hard because finding data on domestic debt crisis is very hard because usually governments try to hide that. So it's a very important, but much harder topic. Also something which is going to be worked in the next months is building an economic indicator for external debt crisis. Something that has almost never been done in economic research. But this is something we're going to work on. So we have a lot of things to be done here. And thank you.
Are they independent or not?
Of course not.
So how do you count the probabilities of crisis in this case?
So we have a matrix, we came up with those ACD, and then there's a slide there where it's like a formula, probability of crisis.